Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak with Dr. Linda Mobula, a physician affiliated with the Division of General Internal Medicine at Johns Hopkins. Dr. Mobula first became interested in the use of investigational drugs during public health crises when she worked in West Africa fighting the Ebola outbreak. She recently returned from New York, where she volunteered to take care of COVID patients. We speak about the investigational drug hydroxychloroquine and COVID-19. This interview was recorded before President Trump disclosed that he takes hydroxychloroquine. Let's listen. Dr. Mobula, thank you so much for joining me. Now, I know that you are no stranger to the use of investigational drugs in the middle of a public health crisis. Can you tell me a little bit about your experience with the Ebola outbreak?
Thank you, Dr. Sharfstein, for having me. I participated in the Ebola response in West Africa in 2014, working at an Ebola treatment unit in Liberia, and administered an investigational drug to an American physician who became ill, Dr. Camp Brantley. And several other individuals received investigational drugs during this response in all three countries, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea.
Let me ask you a question about that. Had anyone received this drug before when you gave the medication?
Nobody else had received the drug prior to Kent Brantley.
And so what's it like to give someone a medication, someone who's pretty critically ill or whose life is really in danger, we can say that, not knowing whether it's going to work?
It was extremely challenging to make that decision, given the limited amount of evidence that existed at the time. There had been a couple of trials in non-human primates that showed efficacy or effectiveness. However, this drug in particular had not been tested in a human being before. And there had been several discussions with Centers for Disease Control, NIH, and the researchers who actually created the drug from University of Winnipeg on its use. And because Dr. Brantley was a physician or is a physician, I think it did help with informed consent and having a better understanding of the risks and benefits, but you never know what will happen when administering a drug that had never been tested in humans. Obviously, it carried a big risk.
Yeah, and your correction of the verb there is pretty important because Dr. Brantley made it through.
That is correct. He did survive and received supportive care, which was a standard of care and continues to be the standard of care for Ebola virus disease. He was transferred to Emory Hospital and continued to receive care.
So when you had that experience, that must have triggered your interest in this broader question of how do you give, you know, new medications, unproven, we can say, medications to people without, you know, the benefit of the full drug development process.
That is correct. It did trigger my interest. And obviously this question has come up during the current COVID-19 pandemic response. As I treated patients in New York City, the issue or question of the use of certain investigational drugs such as hydroxychloroquine came up multiple times, given that it is being used at multiple hospitals.
So let's talk about that. People may remember hydroxychloroquine as a medication that got a lot of airtime from the president. A number of people said this could be the game changer we've been looking for. I think there was just an enormous amount of media attention. But the whole time, doctors knew that it had not been proven for this purpose. Is that fair to say?
That is correct. Hydroxychloroquine has been used for the treatment of lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, as well as malaria, and had not been approved for the treatment of COVID-19.
And so what was the argument for why it should be used at all?
There had been very small trials in China and France that suggested that there could be a benefit. In China, there was a non-peer-reviewed study that looked at 100 COVID-19 cases and found that there was improved radiologic findings, enhanced viral clearance, and reduced disease progression. In France, there was a smaller study conducted among 26 patients in Marseille. And this study showed that there had been some benefit as well. So those were the two studies that suggested that hydroxychloroquine might have a benefit in COVID-19 patients. And this is in addition to in vitro studies that looked at blocking viral entry into cells and activity against SARS.
So that seems like a lot of evidence. So what's the problem?
There are many problems. Actually, this is not a lot of evidence because, as you know, randomized controlled trials should be the gold standard. These studies were underpowered and actually do not provide evidence that hydroxychloroquine is beneficial. Since then, there have been a couple of other studies that have been published. One that was recently published in the New England Journal of Medicine, showing that there is no benefit in terms of reducing the risk for intubation. A retrospective study was done at several VA hospitals in the US among about 368 patients, and those studies did not demonstrate that hydroxychloroquine reduced the need for a ventilator or reduced the risk of death.
So while these different studies are coming out, while the drug may be on the rise or on the decline in people's kind of estimation, you're working in the hospital taking care of COVID. So just like you were at the bedside in Liberia, you're at the bedside now in New York trying to decide what to do that's best for your patients. So take us through what that's like.
I think as a clinician, you must always be guided by ethical principles. Do no harm. Beneficence, informed consent, and justice. Those are the four ethical principles that always guide me as I treat patients. In addition to that, obviously, we need an evidence base to guide us as clinicians as we treat patients. And given that there's a lack of formal guidance on hydroxychloroquine, it makes it very difficult to determine whether or not you should use it or not. I think, number one, there is a lack of evidence. And as a busy clinician treating multiple patients, you don't necessarily always have the time to review the evidence. And you expect this evidence to come from a formal technical body, like the World Health Organization, the National Institutes of Health, FDA, et cetera. And so as a clinician, in addition to ethical principles, as I mentioned, technical guidance from a formal body should provide us with the evidence needed to use or not to use.
Right. You didn't really have that much of that, though. You had some statements by CDC and FDA saying, here's the evidence, more or less, that exists, but not saying really whether it should be used, it's recommended for use or not recommended for use. There was no real guidance part of that. Would that be fair to say?
That is fair to say. The NIH recently came up with guidelines saying that there is insufficient evidence to guide the use of hydroxychloroquine.
So that's more recent.
That is more recent.
Yeah, but for a long time, you know, there really wasn't very much. Did patients ever show up or their family members and ask for it?
All the time. Patients asked whether or not their family members would be on hydroxychloroquine. And as more data emerged on the fact that it might not be effective, patients were asking, well, why is my family member on hydroxychloroquine? Why are they not on remdesivir, for example? So families are listening to the news. They are following this very closely because of the lack of a proven treatment.
Yeah.
And they obviously want to do better. They want their family members to do better. And so I think we have a responsibility to provide the best care possible and to make sure that it's evidence-based. But in the absence of evidence-based trials or conclusive evidence, I think we have to be guided by ethical principles and use as much evidence as we can.
Yeah. So you had a situation, it sounds like, that the doctors were sort of left to either look at the research themselves or kind of wonder what might be the right thing to do. And the families the same. They were listening to the media reports one way or another and without a lot of guidance. And it seems like a lot of hydroxychloroquine was probably given to patients. And right now, we're not quite sure what the net effect of that was. Would that be fair to say?
That is correct, though certain hospitals did have guidelines that recommended the use of hydroxychloroquine in the context of very close monitoring of their QT by getting several EKGs. However, you are correct in that there was limited formal guidance on whether or not it is effective, whether it should be used definitively for patients.
So, you know, we're still waiting for some more studies on hydroxychloroquine. Is that true?
That is correct. The World Health Organization has set up what we call, what they're calling a solidarity trial, and they're comparing four treatment options against standard of care. And this is a large randomized controlled trial involving multiple countries. And this should provide additional evidence on the effectiveness of hydroxychloroquine.
So given your experience with investigational drugs in this setting, let me ask you a few questions about maybe how this could have been done differently. Do you think that given the initial data that was there, that hydroxychloroquine should have been an option for clinicians in the first place? Or do you think that it would have been better to wait for more definitive data before any kind of authorization was given?
I think it was too early to state that it should have been used as an option for treatment. I think there should have been separation between politics and science. I think there was a move to push for the use of hydroxychloroquine, and globally it's being used as a result of these very small trials that have been inconclusive. The World Health Organization set up an ethical framework called the Monitored Emergency Use of Unregistered and Investigational Interventions for Ebola during the 9th outbreak in DRC. And that framework, I think, should have provided additional guidance. I think some of the criteria for the use of investigational drugs were fulfilled. There's no proven treatment that exists. It was impossible to initiate a randomized controlled trial immediately. However, I think there should have been more data providing preliminary support of the intervention's efficacy and safety. That should have been considered a little bit more strongly. And looking at more of a risk-benefit analysis.
So you're suggesting, in other words, that this question of whether or not an unproven therapy could be used really needs more organized focus.
That is correct. I think there needs to be a technical body at the national level, whether it's in the United States or another country, that looks at these questions rigorously and that provides strong recommendations for or against the use of these investigational drugs.
And certainly, while hydroxychloroquine is now maybe a little bit more out of favor as we wait for the next set of data, there are a whole bunch of other things that are surging in interest.
That is correct. Remdesivir is another drug that's being considered. And it's an antiviral that was actually included in the randomized controlled trial looking at the effectiveness of investigational therapies for Ebola in DRC. And in addition to remdesivir, there's an antiretroviral against HIV, Calitra, that's also being looked at as part of this large solidarity trial that's set up by WHO. Interferon beta, I think, is also being looked at. And so, yes, there are several drugs that are going to be included in randomized controlled trials and observational studies worldwide. But I think the lessons learned from hydroxychloroquine should guide the use of these drugs as well. Remdesivir was just authorized by the FDA for emergency use, given that it reduces hospitalization time, but there's no data on mortality, for example. Mm-hmm.
There wasn't a significant finding on mortality, but it was stopped early. It was a pretty well-designed trial. So that led to certainly a stronger recommendation for remdesivir than had ever been in place for
hydroxychloroquine, at least from the senior officials like Dr. Fauci.
That is correct. That is correct. And there are still questions about whether or not it should be used in moderate disease to prevent the progression to severe disease. Who should get it? Is there enough room to severe for everybody?
Right.
What are the criteria to determine who gets it or not?
So in other words, even in that example, it would help to have a more formal process to be able to be more specific about where is it really recommended and on what basis.
Absolutely. There needs to be a more formal process in place. And I think we can look at the ethical framework that Murray established. In addition to just providing an ethical framework, there was data that was collected on these investigational drugs that guided, obviously, the creation of the randomized controlled trial that resulted from Murray.
Got it. So we're going to get better data, but even when we get better data on the old new drugs, we're going to have new drugs to consider. And so getting on top of this challenge would really help.
Absolutely. I think we need to establish a framework right now. Let's not wait until additional drugs are suggested. And this will happen because until there's a proven treatment, we will continue to have drugs suggested by multiple parties in various countries.
Great. Well, this is really fascinating. And I really appreciate your perspective. And thank you so much for everything you've done as a clinician, both for Ebola and COVID, you've really had a remarkable set of experiences.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.